get my mic ready. Oh, get Tucker ready. Push the button. Start the Tucker. He's not starting.
Oh, I'm hosting. No, I'm not.
You're not hosting nothing. Are you hosting me? You're hosting my channel?
I want to.
That's fine. Don't worry about it. So welcome to episode 2 of Heavy Metal Dungeon Masters with John and Tucker, where we chat up role-playing games and other things. Probably going to talk about some music right now. We were kind of chatting a little bit beforehand. And the idea is, like, I'm trying to help Tucker out a little bit with his future endeavors here in the Dungeons Masterings in the lake. So how to... So last week, we talked a lot of stuff last week, for sure. We did. What lingered with you?
I think just everything that we touched on to not scare people away was the big ones.
Not scare people away. This is an excellent way to go about it. Yeah, like it is so easy to deter someone.
Yeah.
Like, it's so easy. They're new, they've heard things, they can get intimidated, and you want to abate that as much as possible. Absolutely.
I think the big draw that helps me is I know that there's some apprehension that's going to pop up of, like, sure, it just looks like a bunch of math. Oh my God, there's all these numbers on the page. And I'm over here like, I'm god awful at math and I play the hell out of this game.
Yeah, I get what you're saying. I think you just kind of have to, like, I've had people, I got some players in my group that are like, that are kind of rough at math. And there's kind of a delicate balance there of, like, you know, when they roll their dice, I can look at their dice and I can tell you what they got, like, like, immediately. Do I do that, or do I let them count it up how they want to count it up? And sometimes we kind of go back and forth on it. Sometimes, like, it's fine, but, like, I've had times where, like, you know, they're dropping, like, 12 dice or something like that, and they need to count it up, and it's a lot, and it's going to hold back the game. So, sometimes I do want to, you know, just, make sure that, you know, that it's going ahead and everything like that, too. So, but I think one of the biggest tricks to that, too, is if you do have veteran players, to delegate to them somewhat.
Okay.
Let them know that, like, hey, this person's new, you know, but make sure they also know the trick that, like, they're not going to do everything for them, to leave options open. Don't backseat game them. That's a big thing, man. Backseat gaming is, like, the worst. That's you can't have them do that. Just let them know, like, hey, you know, you have that spell there that might fill in for this. But don't tell them to, don't be like, you know, you should cast that spell right now. That would help us a lot. You know, give them the option or make them think about that and stuff like that too. Yeah,
kind of coaching rather than having
it. Yeah, that's a good way to put it. Coach them. No, that's a great way to put it. Help coach them. You know, don't backseat game from. Don't play the character. It's not your character, but, like, make sure that they know that, like, that's their what they want to do, and that they can kind of kick it over and stuff like that too. Yeah. So delegate. I think delegating is a big thing. I think that's something I didn't do when I was a younger Dungeon Master, was delegate. That my players can do stuff, and it doesn't have to necessarily be in-game stuff, man. I mean, it could be like we run in the game, make sure someone knows where to go grab you a drink.
Yeah,
I mean, you know, I got a friend that knows how to make my coffee. Like, he knows how to use my coffee maker, so I'm like, hey, go make my coffee. No, seriously, dude. But, like, I don't have to worry about that. That's actually the one thing the pandemic's been nice about, is I don't have my friends coming to my house drinking my fucking coffee.
Yeah. So, we talked about intro dungeons as well, or, like, intro quests. Yeah, that was another thing that we touched on that I've been pondering on.
I think it's just start with the most generic shit in the world, man. They find an overturned cart in the middle of the woods.
Yeah.
You know, they're traveling somewhere because they heard something very generic.
Yeah.
They're there for there's a variety of reasons to be in a place. Don't have them all there for the same reason. Oh, you're all seeking fame and fortune. Maybe they're not. Maybe they're there because, like, they could be visiting a cousin. Or, like, I mean, you know, someone's like, well, I want to go and find my fame and fortune. And someone else is like, well, I want to go visit my cousin. And someone else is like, well, I want to find this, like, person that knows, like, where to find hidden herbs in the forest or something like that.
Yeah.
And then you get to town, you find out they've all been abducted by the goblins. You know? Or that the goblins have occupied the cavern where that one rare herb can be found. You know? I mean, there's all these little things you can kind of incentivize them with. I think this is a big thing that 5th edition did very well, was the idea of like the bonds, flaws, the motivations, all this crap, mm-hmm. versus overall alignment. Alignment's very much taken a back seat, which is fine. If you don't like alignment, yeah. that's fine. Don't play with alignment. We have it in my game, but it's kind of it's just like, I mean, calling it a guideline is not even there. It's more of kind of just something to like look at and reference and such like that too. So we're cool with that. Make sure to draw on those. And even as a dungeon master, maybe like have like a quick card in front of you with those. We use, let me find it real quick. And I don't know if I have a copy handy. We actually do a questionnaire. I do questionnaires, man. Like I do freaking survey. I survey my players before a game, like straight up. Like, I mean, I do like Google surveys and stuff like that for them. And I have them fill it out. And I ask them, like, you know, what did you like last time? I don't have them do this every session, but I have them do this like between campaigns. And it goes pretty far. Let me see if I can find. Where is it? It is under. Because we also did a character questionnaire, which is really interesting. And let me see if I can find. Man, I got way too much crap in my Google Drive here. No, it wasn't the online. There it is. And so one thing I did was I did. I'll go through these real quick here. Okay. So I think one cool thing to do if you're doing a campaign is do a 10 things you need to know list as a dungeon master. Like, what are 10 things they should know about this world or the situation they're in? So for mine, they were playing a sequel to a campaign that was 20 years after the fact. But there's like, you know, they should know. There's like 10 things they should know have happened in the last 20 years. What are the significant events? What were the ramifications of the final event in their thing? And I used their actions in the previous campaign to articulate that. But what a lot of it was is I actually came up with that later. The first thing I asked him was, what do you think your character after that last campaign would do after that directly? Like, what would be their goal? You know, what do you think would happen? What's a character in the previous campaign, like an NPC that you are really curious about? And then, you know, or some sort of circumstance, what are the ramifications of that? And so that went over really well. And this is kind of a quick cheat sheet. I think mine's 2 pages. I have this shareable. I can actually share this. I'll share. Let me share this real quick here. In the chat. There's a really long thing now on our screen with the link. But you can see that in the Google Doc. And that was like the 10 things you should know about this campaign. Right. The other one I did was character questionnaire. And so this one came after that. So my first thing was like, all right, what do you guys want to see? Okay, and then what do you think happened? So the next one was like, okay, well, here's what's happened. Now, your character lives in this world. Your new character lives in this world. Okay, here's a questionnaire for them. And so this one, I think I've edited this. I'm not sure if this is the most contemporary one. And my buddy Jeremy did most of this. For me, he's an art player, so it's like it's a delegation. But okay. We asked a few questions in this. And currently you are Anonymous Mink. So someone named Anonymous Mink is looking at this. All right. I always love a little Anonymous. I like Anonymous Aardvark is my favorite one. But so the questions are like, you know, what's your character's most firmly held belief? Okay, good question. What do they value? And how do they judge things? So how do they base their judgments on? Fight or flight, when you're presented with shocking or dangerous situations, how do you react? So you can make that kind of contingent based stuff like that. What do they want to achieve? What is a sin or a vice you're prone to? Who are 3 people that are important to you? And like that you that would elicit an emotional response if you saw them is really good. What's something your character is doing now that would be shocking to them 10 years ago? That's a great question. I mean, think about yourself for instance. We all, you know, it was a kind of a classic saying, like, you know, look at yourself 10 years ago, I bet you're a jackass. You know, what is your character, why does your character need to be the party and why should they want you? What would it take for your character to decide to attack another player character? Because it does happen. We've had that happen in a few games. Our finale in the last campaign, actually, they fought the big boss, and then there was kind of like the boss had access to magic of a certain type. And one of the players was like, well, yeah, we killed the evil guy that was going to use it, but I'm going to be the one to use it, and that'll be okay. And everyone else is like, no.
No.
And so they fought. Like, they fucking went at it. It was like my final fight of the battle was PvP. And then...
And you would just run that. You would just officiate that the same way you would like a monster encounter.
Yep. Oh, yeah. That's all compatible. Yeah. They were trying to stop each other. And then the one character that was a mercenary in the party, like... was like, well, I have a contract with them, so I'm going to help them.
Yeah.
Not you. And so they actually got through and used the technology. Or used the magic. What's a piece of history? This is the ones that I think are really good. So these are all kind of independent of your character. Like, they're all this kind of stuff you can sit down, like, the character can kind of do by themselves. But then you want to start asking ones that are about with the other players. And one of them that's really good is, like, what kind of history does your character share with the character sitting to your right?
Okay.
And that one's really interesting. Like, how do they know each other? Or maybe they've seen each other beforehand somehow. You know, or they were at a common event. So somehow they've encountered each other before. Instead of just being complete asshole strangers that show up to a place. And the last two are the ones that we actually had the most fun with. These number 10 and 11 is what's a secret your character knows and what's a secret your character doesn't know.
Okay.
And so we used this in when we played Ravenloft, actually. And I was playing in that one. I played a druid, shifter druid, a moon druid, a human. And the secret my character didn't know was that my character's mother was actually a werewolf, and that came up in Ravenloft, and it was a lot of fun. It was a good kind of spark for the storyline, and it was good. The other players were shocked by it. My character, I kind of roleplay that was shocked by it, but it was a good place to go. And then I have stuff character like the last ones here, but like your character's thoughts on like various major events in the world. The Doom, if you read my history, is the thing on the Doom. What character religious beliefs? What do they think of the political situation? Who are they vying for king? Mm-hmm. So this kind of stuff goes like, it goes pretty far. So they don't just kind of show up blind. Now I'm going to tell you, that's going to be intimidating to a new player if you just toss that at them. What I would do is I would run just a one, like I said, run the one shot with just some characters they make up that just seem fun. And then one or two games like that, let them get used to it. And be like, all right, now we're going to start the campaign, dude. And do you want to stay with that character, or do you want to do a new character?
Yeah.
Okay, you want to do a new character, or use that character? I need to answer these. And they'll be more inclined to understand how to answer them. So, yeah.
Have you ever run anything like a mega dungeon? Like a big old, big bastard?
I ran the Doom Vault.
Okay.
Which is
pretty cool. I have heard of that one.
Yeah, I ran that one out of the one out of I modified it for my own storyline and stuff like that and purposes, but yeah, I ran that one. It was pretty good. They're not bad.
Okay. Would you drop beginners in something like that just as a dip your toes in deal? Like just to get used to gameplay mechanics, or would you?
So for a few reasons I wouldn't, and here's why. One, typically if you're dungeon delving something like a mega dungeon, your characters are more powerful, so they're gonna be higher level. They're not gonna be first level.
Okay.
You'll kill them. it doesn't... Dungeons by themselves tend not to be contextualized. It's like you're in the dungeon to survive and to get your treasure or whatever it is. So there's not really like an incentive or reason for them to be there. Okay. There's a really good... I want to say it's 3.5. I can't remember in the fourth edition book talking about the dungeon as like an abstract idea. There isn't like, it just means you're in an environment that has confines of some sort. And so it can be a forest, whatever it is.
I think I read that.
I think the best dungeons are like the initial ones are really good. Are like, okay, Goblin Caves, classic.
Yeah.
The Lost Mines of Phandelver does have a big dungeon at the end. If you actually look at it, it's actually a pretty damn big dungeon, but it kind of builds up to that. Like initially there's like, okay, you're in like the Goblin Caves, and then there's like the it's not a haunted man, it's like an abandoned fortress, you know. So it kind of scales up as it goes, you know.
Okay.
But if they don't know like the tips and tricks of like traps, they're gonna feel cheated pretty quick. And yeah, I think that's kind of my my angle on it. And the mega dungeons are fun, but they're I like to build up to them.
Okay.
You know, and make sure that the players go in like. Because, like, I feel like unless, like, they're being teleported into and forced into it, like, most characters aren't just, like, oh, I got my gear one day. I'm going to go roll up in a fucking dungeon. They're, you know, they're trying to build up to go to that or find those. And then it also makes them less frequent, you know? It makes it, like, that much... It's kind of a cool treat when they get to go to one.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
What are your... What are your thoughts on Thaco? Like, you started playing in the time when it was like the deal.
Yeah. Thaco. Thaco is just a reversal of the to hit modifier.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just kind of an abstract thing. It's the same as hit modifier. I find that people like to understand that rolling higher is better. That's easy.
Yeah.
And then they like to they also like to know the stats. The higher the stat, the better. So higher AC made a lot more sense than it did lower AC. People didn't really grasp that. And so, I mean, it's fine. It's a way to go. It's a little confusing for people initially, but Thaco was essentially just a table. I mean, that was the premise. It was just a table.
It was just you'd look at a table.
Yeah, so it makes sense on a table. It doesn't make sense in terms of like if you're just running numbers.
Yeah,
and I think that's my issue with it. And why I would try, I would just convert everything into like just to hit modifiers, and then AC goes up.
That's just hard to do. You were just converting everything to ascending armor class, anyways.
I mean, you might as well at this point. I think.
Yeah,
it's just easier for people to understand. I think that the higher number, the better. The higher the hit bonus, the better. Yeah. The higher the AC, the better.
That's I'm really thankful that a lot of the OSR stuff gives you the option for ascending armor class, because that's what I learned to play in, because I started with 3.5. Mm. And having to whip out a table to do Thaco, it seems clunky. It seems like a big pain.
Yeah, I mean, it's just to hit AC zero. So the idea is like your Thaco initially starts off as like a 20 or some shit like that.
Yeah.
So that basically means
zero is the best armor class.
Yeah, zero is like the theoretical upper limit, or like without magic or whatever it is. And so it's kind of like it's just the same thing. I mean, that's the thing. It's just the same probabilities. That's the thing. It's the same exact probabilities.
Yeah, just flipped.
Yeah, so the one that I really didn't like in second edition, or that kind of edition, was like I didn't like how if you had multiple attacks a turn, it was like every other turn. Like it's like in second edition, like fighters would get like they were the first to get multiple attacks.
Yeah,
and the way it worked is your attacks per turn, I'm not gonna kid you, was listed as 3/2, so you had 3 attacks every 2 turns. So what that meant is like your first round you have 1 attack, the next round you have 2 attacks, and you have 1 attack, and you have 2 attacks. It was really fucking confusing.
Yeah, that seems clunky.
Yeah, it is really clunky. And so
you started with second edition, didn't you?
Yeah, that was my first edition I played. Yeah.
Okay.
I played 80 second edition. I've played a little bit of first. I take it back. The first edition I played was like expert rules.
And then, okay.
But that was like once or twice we played when I was like really like I mean when I first started, and then we went over to AD&D because it was much more plentiful. I mean that's what it came down to. Yeah.
They were churning out a lot more AD&D stuff than any of the BX.
Yeah, there's a whole history behind that shit. Like the
I've been diving into it a little bit the past few weeks just because it's fascinating.
Yeah, getting the Buck Rogers stuff is where it gets weird.
Yeah.
Because like the gal owned fucking. Had a claim in Buck Rogers, so she wanted ATC TSR to produce Buck Rogers. Which actually, they made a few video games. They're like Pool of Radiance. It's like it plays just like Pool of Radiance and all those old like school ones, but it's freaking Buck Rogers. I had one of them. It's pretty bad. So, anyways, I think the trick with the rules is just like streamline it and let them understand. You know. Give them a cheat sheet, man. I mean, give them a 3x5 card that has 3 things on it. Says how to do an attack roll, how to do a skill check, how to do a saving throw, and that's it. That's all they need to know. In 5th edition, that's how I would do it.
Okay.
you know, but don't let them get hung up on it. Don't let them get like worried. Yeah. Hey everyone, let's jump into it. I appreciate you guys jumping in. If you guys want to throw questions or talk about whatever's cool,
ask us anything.
Yeah, ask us anything, please.
Yep.
I'll yeah. So what else from last week, man? You want to kind of catch up on? This is good stuff.
I'm trying to remember all the stuff from last week. We did cover a lot.
Yeah.
This week. Fuck.
I think one of the I started up that the Eyes of the Hash game, and that one's been really, I've been really enjoying that one, running that one, but and the players are super cool, but it's like, I think the trick to that one was like, I didn't kill him, dude. Like I kind of created a threat, but I never like killed him.
Yeah.
And one thing I've liked about, especially since fourth edition with the death saves, is like you can kind of survive getting the shit kicked out of you.
Yeah.
It's not instant death where like in second edition 3.5, like, I mean, you hit -10, you're toast. That's it. It's game. And so it's this kind of element that like you can get the crap kicked out of you and still have time to like sustain and whatever it is. So I think another thing too is to make sure that you don't just like beat up on them, but they should be punished for dumb actions.
Yeah. And put the fear of God into them.
Yeah, like if they think they can just rush anybody, you know, make them aware, like try to build that villain as like, you know, you see that they seem to have a level of skill or whatever it is. They you know, they have better gear than you. They're, you know, you're not sure like the entire surroundings, you can't see everything. Give them opportunities to like, you know, drop hints that they might want to, you know, go away. You know, let them kind of set up that way. That's a good way to go.
My 5e game that I play over Zoom,
yeah,
on Thursdays, one of our barbarians actually almost died.
Uh-huh.
Like he was at zero and he had to make his death saves. It was close, man. And
yeah, that's tense stuff, you know. You have to like, you have to kind of be careful. And I think that's a good thing, is to make sure that they're going to be careful. I got a question here. Is there a class you wouldn't recommend for the first time players to get their feet wet with? Yeah, I would really recommend against spellcasters. I think we talked about this a little bit last week, but like, I recommend against like spellcasters for the most part. Sorcerer is not bad. I think sorcerer is pretty easy to manage because it's a limited number of spells. Wizard, I would definitely not do. Cleric can be pretty intimidating because you have access to everything.
Mm-hmm.
But generally, spellcasters is what I recommend against people playing initially. I highly recommend Fighter and Rogue off the bat. Ranger isn't bad either, because it doesn't get spells for a little bit, and the spells it does get are very, very limited. The other one, Barbarian's good too. Yeah, Barbarian.
Yeah, Barbarian's an amazing starter character. That's what I started with.
Yeah, those are all really strong things. Paladin ain't bad because like you don't get spells for a while. So like it helps out, but then like the problem with Paladin is that like they become so dependent upon their smites that like you have to understand how spells work and everything like that too. So
yeah,
but I would highly recommend against wizards. Highly recommend against clerics. Druids can be kind of tricky too.
And like any kind of basic fighter or like a ranger is a good starting point. My wife, her and I both had our first playthrough together, and. So her starter was a ranger and mine was a barbarian.
Yeah, there's like, if we're doing fifth edition, there's like certain subclasses I would avoid. Mm-hmm. So like with rogue, thief is like really easy to play. Like thief's actually one of the best ones, to be honest. Assassin we call the one trick pony. It's a hell of a trick, but it's one trick.
Yeah.
And our players that play assassins, they want to do that trick over and over again. I'm like, it's just,
they want a button spam.
They want to just mash the button that says assassinate, and it's like, okay, cool, but it doesn't come up all the time. It's not relevant.
Right.
Thief is really cool because you could like, it makes them like, your character can now suddenly get into anywhere very quickly. It's easy to play. Fighter, champion, I'm not gonna keep my champion ain't bad. Champion's actually pretty solid.
Yeah.
The high crit range is cool. Battlemaster's pretty complicated. I'll say that. Barbarian, Totem Warrior is like, I'm not gonna do Totem Warrior is like the easiest to play, and it's also probably one of the best. We have someone playing, I think Michael and my in Eyes of the Hash is playing a Ancestral Guardian Barbarian. That one's a little more complicated. Let's see, they want all of these spellcasters. I'm definitely trying to talk two of them out of it. Also, just round out the party. Yeah. I mean, you can have spellcasters. I mean, clerics can be pretty tough. Don't get me wrong. Like, you play pretty freaking a war cleric or a life cleric is going to sustain for a while. Also, the, what is it? The storm cleric. Like, you worship Thor or some shit like that. Those guys can hold down, man. Storm cleric's actually pretty badass.
I just think it's so fascinating, the RPG archetypes that everybody kind of gravitates towards just in their personal lives. Mm-hmm. Yeah, like how everybody kind of has a different class that they like to play in these kinds of games.
Yeah, it's interesting. Really interesting. My nephew's like hooked on like Dwarf Fighters.
Okay.
And he's been playing Dwarf Fighter in all my games since he started playing with us about 15 years ago. And so he's 30 now, so let's just put it in perspective. And but this campaign, he decided to play a cleric. He wanted to play a dwarf, but he wanted to play a cleric, and he went with Cleric of the Forge. So he was kind of looking at War Cleric initially, but then like he went with Cleric of the Forge because he kind of liked the elements of it, and he liked having the fiery hammer and all that kind of, or a fiery hammer and all that kind of stuff. So it was kind of cool, like, for him to go with that. And he also wanted to play a character that used a two-handed weapon versus like sword and board, which is kind of his style.
Yeah.
Axe and shield, whatever it was. And so he swapped up, and he kind of, after some time, made, I don't want to say compromise, but he definitely like, kind of pushed over into something else. My other friend, Daniel, who's been playing with me pretty consistently for, about 15 years or so, he jumps around. He played, when he first played with me, he played a ranger. Then he went on a sorcerer, played a sorcerer for a very long time. Really like sorcerers. Then last campaign, he played a paladin. Fourth edition played an Avenger. I think it was the Avenger. And then now he's playing a Bard Sorcerer. And he plays a melee Bard. He plays we have a homebrew sorcerer we're using called the Noble, which is like a little more melee-ish. And he plays a Bard that's a little more melee-ish. So like he fights as a sword and shield and breastplate. So he can actually go frontline it, but he's not like a hard frontliner. He can just sustain for a while and provide support. And you know, but he has like a cool sword, so it's kind of a cool play. He likes playing different styles. We have one friend, our friend Karis, that plays with us. She plays archers. Last campaign was a ranger, this one's arcane archer. So
my wife always plays archers.
Yeah, I mean, archers aren't bad, don't get me wrong, man. We can, you know, we can listen to Heart the Archer's Dream all day long.
Yeah,
but so that's kind of fun. I had one of my players. See, Anthony played. What did he play initially? Did I kill his character? He was playing a paladin, and then his paladin got maimed, we'll say. And he went over to a wizard because he's seeing how glamorous I made them to seem. Then he realized how hard they were to play. So now he's playing a wizard.
It's the class with homework.
It's got the class with homework. Yeah, he plays a conjurer. And he wanted to like be this like interplanar traveler, but he's like as a player, he's still kind of getting used to the planes.
Yeah.
And so when you have someone that can jump planes, you have to kind of like, that's a whole other thing to talk about when you get characters, because my group is off 15th level, so they can jump planes almost at will. But the problem is that like he can only have certain planes he can jump to. Right now in the game they're trying to get to the Hells, and their problem is that they know they can get there, they just don't know if they can get there safely.
Right.
And they're worried about jumping into a place where the guys on the other side are going to be like, all right, dude, time to pay the toll. And they're going to be like, oh, well, we don't have that. And they're like, well, guess what you might have is a soul. So, like, they're worried about that shit. So they're trying to figure out a more secure way. And my problem with them is that they actually have fucking connections. We've been playing this game for 2.5 years, 3 years. They have connections. They met a dragon. They got conned into resurrecting an ancient green dragon. Jeez. that like came back and cut a deal with them, and like the dragon was like, yeah, I've been dead for a while and I sit at like the left hand of Tiamat and I want to go back there. So these people that conned you into them, I want to punch them first. But then the party has a luck blade that has like wishes in it. Mm-hmm. And he's like, and I'll give you this luck blade, but like you got to use your first wish to wish me back to the side of Tiamat. And so they're like, okay. So they have a connection. They got a boy that's got the ear of Tiamat down there. They could go talk to, you know, they might be able to hook them up. But they have other people that have been down there. So it's kind of like I'm having trouble with my party now because they're not thinking about their actual connections. But I, Jason, I would go with, I mean, push them to Sorcerer or Cleric if they really are insistent. Druid's not bad either. I'm going to tell you, Druid's not bad. I do like Druids. I play a melee Druid, actually. My Druids are my druids tangle. No pun intended. Primal, what is it? How was that one? Primal Strike, whatever it is, the one where you grow claws is really good. Because I usually run a Druid with a shield and Primal Strike. So I can, like, I have, like, a melee spell that I use. Okay. It's pretty good. It's actually pretty good. And the two, I will say this, the two Druid builds out of the Player's Handbook actually are both amazing. The Circle of the Land. Circle of the Land has one of the... You will have the Circle of the Land character has the largest list of readied spells in the game, bar none. No one comes close. Because you keep on getting more and more lands, and so your ready list goes huge. I think I built like a ninth level one. I had like 45 spells ready a day or something like that. Like, I mean, like just whatever I need to cast, I can cast. So it was really cool. And Circle of the Moon's pretty easy to play too because you're beefy, you turn into a big bear. So, all right. But yeah, you got more questions. I handle them up too, but I can hear talk to Tucker about other concerns too.
Do you have any like special way of calculating XP, or do you just kind of go off?
So experience points is an interesting controversy, and there's some things to understand about the origins of experience points in role playing games. So in pretty much 3.5 and on. Experience points were flat, so the idea is like all second level characters need the same amount of experience points to go up a level. Okay, if you go back and look at the second edition, they all the different classes need different numbers to go.
Yeah, they all level up at different rates. And
yeah, so what that is that it's important to understand that the equivalent power of a character was based on their experience points, not their level. So it wasn't that like a second level wizard was the equal of a second level rogue. It's that a second level rogue was still trying to catch up to a first level wizard, essentially, at points. Yeah. In terms of power. And then you have, that's why wizards need some experience points, because wizards in second edition D&D are, I mean, they're freaking stupid powerful. Like, how a 20 level wizard, you can't beat them. If they're ready, they're going to kill everything they can do. And so there's this kind of element to think about with what experience points actually represent in your game. I've broken off of experience points. I used to use them, but the problem was, I would have players that couldn't make a session and they could get lagged. And that kind of felt like a way to, I was kind of punishing them. And so I kind of stopped doing that. Experience points is also something you have to like kind of calculate and all stuff like that too. Now my buddy Jeremy, when he ran Ravenloft for us, what he did was he went through and looked at all the experience points in that adventure and kind of like clumped them into major facets. And what he basically did was like each one was so many, like every time we did something, it was worth so many basically tick marks. And once we got so many tick marks, we went up a level.
Okay.
And so he went and did kind of the math for us way ahead of time. And that was a decent way to go too. I now just kind of level my players up whenever, like after, not just whenever I feel like it. If I feel like they're ready for it, or they have a major milestone, or there's some sort of achievement. And it you know, it's kind of I like it because it takes the pressure off me and I just kind of do it when I want to.
Yeah.
But if you're playing an older school style, like basically second edition before, experience points make a lot more sense. Especially when you get into higher levels, because like your hit you basically cap hit dice. That's one thing that a lot of people understand about second edition is like you're it doesn't matter what class you are, your character caps at 10 hit dice.
Yeah.
Like that's it. Like, and then you might get a few extra hit points here and there, but it's pretty minimal. Versus like you always get hit dice. So there's a really interesting kind of, that's a really interesting way to think about the game. And it limits the mortality of a lot of players too, which is really kind of cool for me too. If I think about it, because like, you know, we have, I think in my party, my home game, our dwarf sorcerer has the most hit points of the party, like by far.
Oh,
yeah. Yeah, he's got a lot more. He's got more than the fighter.
Yeah. It's kind of an anomaly.
Well, I mean, what it is the fighter in the party is an elf, and she's Dexter's base. She's only, I think she has like a 12 or 14 con, where like the dwarf is a hill dwarf. So he's got like a 16 con. He gets an extra one per level. So he's just jumping on the bonuses.
Jesus.
Yeah, he's just, you know, but he plays as like earth sorcerer. So he's just, I mean, he just rocks up. He just goes hard in and doesn't take damage, basically, is what he does. But it's interesting to play with. It's a lot of fun. I actually enjoy that. It's fun to get to be on the sorcerer. So, I think that like I'm not sure how did the experience was. One thing I do is I just kind of like I kind of take down notes of if I am doing experience wise of what CRs, what challenge ratings, or the numbers they're fighting.
Yeah.
And do it, and then like you can kind of have plotted out stuff like based on. I tend not to do experience points. I wasn't doing like, you know, if they do this they get 1,000. It was more of like. I would give them experience point bonuses for storyline stuff based on how well they handled the storyline. If they got their goals or if they actually engaged in it. If they didn't engage in it or like kind of like skirted over it, it really wasn't worth as many experience points. Because you know then your character really didn't really engage in the thing, if you will. They just kind of did it to do it. Yeah.
Okay.
But it's
yeah, I wasn't sure how commonplace it was to just absolutely hug what the monster manual says, basically.
It's not bad. I mean, it's a way to go. You can run into the issue in there was an old Knights of the Dinner Table that dealt with this where the characters wanted to level, and the dungeon master was kind of holding back on experience points because he knew if they leveled up, they were going to get just a tad too powerful for his taste.
Yeah.
And so one of the characters realized they had so much money, and they kind of went and like looked at like the local livestock auctions, and they realized how many experience points like a sheep was worth, and so they bought enough sheep to slaughter that they would go up a level.
Huh.
But I mean, the argument, but that's why, like in 5th edition, they have what's called CR0 monsters. You have challenge rating 0, which is like where you get 0 experience points for killing it. And then, best case scenario, if it does have a threat, it's worth 10 experience points. So it's like you got to kill a ton of them to like do anything. So it's kind of an interesting element. And you have to ask yourself, like, are you really getting experience in combat with your. With doing this, the other thing too to think about too in second edition was they did you got experience points for other things too. Like I remember rogues got experience points for stealing so much money. Like you got, it was if you stole money or valuables, you got so much experience points for. Wizards got experience points for casting spells, stuff like that. So there's kind of like an element that like the experience doesn't just come from like killing stuff or succeeding in quests. It comes from just using your powers.
Being
yourself, whatever it is. Because like I think one thing we have to consider too, like with the contemporary role playing game environment versus, like you know second edition, and the like, is that we very much live in a world where most people's first experience with role playing games is video games, and they play much more statically. Where you get these for this, you get this for this, and there's this kind of very much a milestone kind of progression. So I think that we have to kind of think about that, and that's a bias that we kind of hold on to, that a lot of people hold on to. So we can kind of think about how we can move through that.
That's my thing another thing that I'm thinking about with new players, because you know in my age demographic, that's probably where a lot of people are approaching this whole role playing game thing from. They're approaching it from video games because that's how a lot of us got started. Yeah. You know,
my first real D&D stuff that I learned all the rules for was from video games, playing the Eye of the Beholder. Yep. That's how I learned it all, pretty much. That, yeah.
I mean, the thing with like so many RPGs now, like your stats aren't readily available on screen. Like you can't see, like, oh god, how many more points do I have before I level up, kind of thing.
They hide a lot of mechanics and such like that too. Sorry, go on.
The drive for creativity, I think, is something that I'm also looking forward to. It's like, well, you're not really just constrained by moving in 8 directions and doing these specific movements and casting this specific spell in this specific direction. You can do some crazy shit if you're creative enough to do it.
Yeah. No, that's exactly it. Yeah, if you start getting a little the rule is kind of a guideline, and you get people that are kind of, they're used to video games where they're very confined, and if they want to come up with different ways to move and stuff like that, that's fine. You know, let them. Yeah. This has been one of my concerns though with especially since fourth edition was that they've realized that people can understand how to break games and they'll look to break games. And so you have there's a lot of spells that are limited. I think the biggest limitation they placed in fifth edition was concentration. If you go look at the spells in Dungeons and Dragons, fifth edition, about 80% of them are concentration. And so the idea there is that you can only concentrate on one spell at a time, so you can't stack stuff up. You can't like make your dude go berserk, or make a bunch of people go berserk for you. And so
because they break the game.
Well, they don't break the game, but the problem is that like they didn't have a better solution is what it came down to. It was a lazy solution in my opinion. In my game we have a homebrew concentration rule where you can actually concentrate on multiple spells. And it works really well. It does have limiter. So basically the way that it works is, if you guys want me, I can give you the math for it real quick. You can concentrate on a maximum number of spells equal to your proficiency modifier minus one.
Okay.
And then the spells you concentrate on can be up, combined level cannot be higher than the highest level of spells you can cast.
Okay.
So what that means is that a fifth level character who has a +3 proficiency can concentrate on two spells, and one of them can be third level, or it can be a second level and a first level, or two first levels.
Okay, that makes sense.
But it couldn't be two second levels, and it couldn't be a third level and anything
else. You don't have to nerf fucking hit dice or anything like that.
No, all I'm doing with that is that I'm saying that like you can concentrate on your high level spells is hard. Yeah. Oh, and then the rule is like if you do break concentration, you lose your highest level spell first.
Okay.
You don't lose all of them; you just lose the highest level one. So it makes
and
it.
You kind just of have them roll for concentration, basically.
What's that?
You just have them roll for concentration.
Yeah, roll for concentration. Oh, you lost concentration. You lose your highest level spell next. So you still have the low level one, and they're equal to random one. So it makes them kind of hesitant. They have to kind of think about that too a little bit. They can't just kind of blow up and everything like that too, so yeah, it's pretty interesting.
I need to familiarize myself with the classes that I don't play a little bit more.
That's an interesting element. So this is another thing too with like new players is like they might, you're asking them, are they going to know the rules better than you, or are you going to ask them to put that burden on them or whatever. This is one of the reasons why like, I recommend restraining it. And even come with pre-made characters, man. I said, here's like five characters I have made. Pick one.
Okay.
You know? And so I think that can go over really well in terms of how you know what they can do. And if they have a question, you can answer it like that. Because if you delay out, the thing is like the longer you delay on stuff like that, the more likely you are to lose them. And you don't want to lose them. You want to keep them engaged and like in the fantasy and stuff like that too. But also, you know, I think it's also really important to be transparent with them that you know you're learning with them.
Mm-hmm.
I have players that like bust out stuff that I'm not familiar with once in a while, or I'm not sure how that works exactly. So I'm like, okay, let's take a look at it. But usually, what I do is I'll just like say, you know, fuck it. Like this is, you know, I'm not sure. I'm gonna take your word for it this time, and then we'll go figure it out later. You know. Yeah, I think that's a good tactic too. Is don't worry, man. If you don't know something, that's fine. You know, you're human. You know.
And also, there's the whole make it up.
Yeah, make it up, man. Just do rule of cool rules, dude. Rule of cool is good. You know, like just run with it. If it's gonna like sound great, that's fine. We had a thing like that a while back. So we had my players were fighting an obelisk. Let me rephrase it. They were fighting three obelisks. I'm really brutal on my players, and one of the players who's the wizard, actually is a gnome wizard. They're in these boats going through these watery caverns, and he busts out his cube of force and pushes it so nothing physical can come through, so the things can't attack him. But he doesn't know about the mental abilities, So one of them, one of the obelisks possesses the actually my friend that plays the Bard Sorcerer and gives him the command to throw the Cube of Force in the water. And so he snaps the Cube of Force from him and then deactivated it and threw it. And the wizard was like, well, he can't push the buttons because he's not attuned to it. It takes an action to attune. But I was like, but here's the thing, at the end of the day, it's freaking cool that your buddy snatches it from you and throws it in the water. You know? So it's stuff like that. Like, it was a much cooler scene than if we were to sit there and do it piece by piece by piece.
Yeah, exactly.
So Kane, you gotta fudge a little bit. And I think that's all right. Like, you know, you let them know you're fudging it too. You know that sounds cool. That's fun. I like that idea. Let's do that. So a few other people came in to join us, man. If you got something you want me to talk about or take a quick question, we got a little bit of time left. Yeah. We have under 15 minutes and stuff like that. So we're having a fun little talk with Tucker. We can also talk about we can also talk show and bands.
That's one of my favorite things to do.
It is. We were talking a little bit of shit earlier. Tucker had a post this week about Ghost, and we're having some conversations about Ghost. I do have a Ghost poster, but I have a very early Ghost poster, we'll say.
Yeah.
When they're legit. Plus, it's Alan Forbes, dude. It's Alan Forbes. He's one of the best poster artists of all times. And so I can't fade on that dude. So there is that. It's like if I have a, you know. I like this paint. You know, you're right. It's a painting Napoleon. I think the guy's an asshole. I don't really like him, but he's a great painter.
Yeah.
you can't. Yeah. So, but if anyone wants to chime in, we'll talk some shit, or we can talk about some fantasy metal or stuff like that too. Whatever's good, man. What do you listen to music when you play?
It depends. Well, when I'm doing my Zoom campaign, I know. Like, I think every other guy in that campaign has their own little playlist going on in the background. Like David Paul Seymour has one that he's like curated specifically for this. My mood music kind of changes. A lot of the times I'll just throw on like Accept. A few weeks ago, I was just listening to Bathory, like the first three Bathory records. And then I went through, last week, I was listening to Kobold. Have you heard of them?
Yeah, I've heard of them. I've heard of them.
I know. I was listening to like the four, I think there's four Kobold albums out right now, and I was just listening to them. Just very, very classically like high adventure dungeon synth. I'm really particular and kind of picky about my dungeon synth.
Yeah.
Like I don't like the super birdsome-y stuff, I guess.
Like, where it's really low key, like very low, or like
where it's like really ambient and like it's like really dark and stuff. I like the more kind of bombastic stuff without getting too dramatic or ominous. Like I think Kobold they nail it.
I know you're talking about. Yeah, they're pretty solid. I have like 100 some odd hour dungeon synth list I listen to. I'll say this, man. If you guys want to get like inexpensive music for your game, Bandcamp Dungeon Synth tag, just storm it, and you can get some really cool bands out there. If you want to know, I'll give you some recommendations real quick. If you want me to, I like the guys that kind of like blend Dungeon Synth with black metal.
Where it almost sounds like there's a riff going, kind of.
Yeah, there's a really good band called L4 that I like. It's like elf, and then the word four, all one. They have a song called Impious Battlefield, I think it is. Impious Battlefields. It's really good. That's all I can listen to forever. There is one of the people I was playing with. Dungeon Deep Records is really good. Yeah, Dungeon Deep Records has a lot of stuff on them. I have my friend that I was playing with, she was playing in Eyes of the Hospital, so she couldn't. Kaylee has a band called More Certa. They did our track for Wolf Lord of Yol, which is a lot of fun. There's a guy out of, I think he's out of San Luis Obispo called Malfet. It's really good, Malfet. I think you'd like him. If you haven't heard Hole Dweller, which is a great name for a band, And then my buddy out of Visalia called Guild of Lore. That's like really diverse in terms of Dungeon okay. synthy. He does some of it's like tavern music and some of it's like dungeon synth. I mean, it's all over the place. He's been super cool.
We did last year. We did that split with Hillsfar.
Okay.
Hillsfar is awesome. It definitely falls into like that adventuring synth kind of thing that I'm kind of trying to zero in on.
Yeah, if you want like kind of more adventuring too, there's a really cool. I want to say the Russian. I could be mistaken. Called Splendorious.
Okay.
There's yeah, that one's really good too. Sidreal Forest is really good. Or Fortress, excuse me, Sidreal Fortress. If you want more like kind of like 8-bitty, like kind of 8-bit like video game, there's a band called Questmaster. I mean, there's a ton, dude. I can go through this shit forever. Like but I like the yeah, I like the kind of like the still the kind of approaches the black metal stuff. It brings a little bit of riffing once in a while. But it has a little bit of lyrics. I'm not a big fan of the lyrics so much, but I like the I kind of like when they bring a little bit of voices. So yeah, by all means. Yeah, that was the cool part, man. It was Kaylee that was playing with us, dude. She's fucking open for Mortis. That was dope.
That's sick.
Yeah, like she was like, oh yeah, I partied with him backstage and shit like that. He was super cool. And I was like, fuck, that's so cool. Like we're all fucking really Mortis, cool. Dude. It's fucking Mortis. Like, dude, he wrote fucking like most of the, like the good Emperor lyrics. Like, come on. Yep.
He wrote my favorite Emperor lyrics.
Which one's that?
Cosmic Keys.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, dude. Yeah. Yeah, that is a trip. I feel bad for him lately because he's been having that fight with his that old record label.
Yeah,
that's fucking nuts, dude. He was ready to launch that record and they said no last minute on him. And it wasn't even something he recorded for them. It was a live recording and they had like in his contract that they, because it was recorded, it was theirs, and it's like he was pissed. So I feel bad, but
that really fucking sucks.
Yeah, yeah. I have his. I have all his records. I have the Centesili Diaboli, the other he did another name. It's like this kind of, it's very different. There's two, I think it's two albums. The Devil Songs is what it's called. Devil Songs.
Okay.
They're really good, but it's kind of another one of his side projects he has. He's got, you know, well, he had a lot of them. So, but yeah, it's a, I don't know. It's a good, the thing about Dungeon Synth is that, like, there's not really a sound to it. Like there's so many kind of like sub sides to it.
And it's so hard to find anything like on the subgenres. Nobody's written like a comprehensive thing to it. Yeah. Like all we know is there's dungeon synth and then there's like cozy synth. And
that's cottage synth. That's it. Cottage yeah. synth. Yeah. I've been seeing that more and more. The cottage synth is kind of a trip to me.
Yeah.
It's taking and making it more fairy tale-ish and more fun and you're more inviting. And I don't know how I feel about that. I go both ways on that too. But yeah, it's kind of fun. I've been trying, so I probably shouldn't share this on stream, because it'll just fucking make all you bastards more competitive. We've been trying to find a copy now for about 2 years. So there is, there is an official Dungeons & Dragons vinyl release. There's actually several official Dungeons & Dragons vinyl releases.
Where did they come out?
I'll post it in the chat for you here, Tucker, because I don't want to like I don't want to fight yeah. people, but there is this. I've heard it. It's not good.
I'll you heard that it's not good. It's when not, did it come out? 85.
85. Yeah. It's kind of like, there. It's not Dungeon Synthy at all. I'll tell you that much. Like it's very
okay. This is modern classical synth pop ambient electro.
Here, I'll.
Is there a YouTube? Has anybody ripped this to YouTube?
I mean, here I'll play a little bit for the I'll play a little bit for the audience here. Yeah, I have my desktop audio on, so I'll play a little bit for you guys here at home. This is the track called Gnomes. It's called Gnomes.
Okay.
In return for favors and the ridding of their ancient enemies, the gnomes lead the heroes into the underworld and the perils within.
Dude,
That certainly exists.
I mean, they must have a dance club or some shit underground. You know? Underground gnome dance club? Yeah.
That's certainly something that, that exists.
It's kind of a trip.
I don't know if I want it, but if I find a copy, it's all yours because okay, cool. I'm good.
I only have two. I have two of the three. I'm looking for the last one. So I remember Kid Stuff Records. So they used to do Kid Stuff Records. Used to use little 7-inch records, and they would come with a book, and you could read the book along with like the record.
Okay.
I have a little ding, and you then turn the page and read the next record. So they made 3 Dungeons & Dragons ones. And I have 2 of them sealed from 84, like sealed with the Kmart sticker on them and everything.
That's awesome.
Because I got them because when the Kmart started closing down, they started like purging all the dead stock and there was a guy that found like crates of these, but I can't find the one. I found one once in a while, but there's one last one called Attack of the Assassins that I'm trying to find. But I have one called Black Dragon Bog, which was awkward because when I first saw like the way that the font on the cover is, I thought at first it said Black Dragon Boy, and I was like, oh, I don't know, that feels kind of weird. And then the other one's called I can't remember, but they're all based on the LJN action figures.
Okay,
they're not the cartoon. It's the LJN action figures, so like Steelheart and I can't remember the Blizzard's name. All those guys, but like War Duke's in there and all that shit too. So like, it's kind of fun. But I'm still trying to accumulate that. Those I did make. I haven't opened them and I haven't listened to them. I made a deal though. We didn't have time though. But when Satine came over in February, Zephyrus came over to my house in February. I told her that if we go live right now, like on whatever, and you want to read these along with me playing these live, I'll do it. Like, I'll fucking do it. We have a fun time, but we didn't get around to it, so I'll have to save it for another time. But they're a trip. They're a trip. Yeah, there's some weird kind of like stuff out there.
The thing that Buster Deadly is Corwin, our other guitar player.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Hi, other guitar player.
The thing that he has the Animated Hobbit and Barbarella on RCA Selectivision, like those big damn picture discs, mm-hmm. like those cartridges that had like
vinyl they're called magnetic. It's a Capistronic. I forget what they're called. I know you're talking about that. I've seen those around. It is
Capacitance electronic discs.
Yeah, CEDs. Yeah. Really fascinating format, because it uses they would pull the audio off of the vinyl, but then they pull the video off of like magnetic information on the top. It's really a weird situation. They don't have you can't do a lot of plays of them because they fucking you're just carving them as you play them.
Yeah,
And there are a lot of moving parts. Yeah, there was a guy down the street, the antique store over, he had like Barbarella. I've heard, I think one of the more expensive ones, I think, on that format is something like the Indiana Jones movies go for a bit. It's kind of a trip, yeah. But yeah, I see him around
with a lot. You know, I've been looking at trying to get one of those players and just try to find as many of those as we possibly can.
It's just hard because it was so many moving parts. Like, that's what it came down to. Yeah. It didn't last that long.
And it came out at a weird time. By the time it actually got released, VHS was already out. Just the thing was stuck. I watched an hour long thing about the RCA Selectivision whenever they were just talking about how long it had just been stuck in like development hell.
Yeah, the last disc was manufactured in 86.
Yeah.
Yeah, not that many titles too. Yeah, I do a whole thing in my engineering class talking about format wars, mm-hmm. Looking at beta and VHS and kind of why that occurred the way it did. Yeah. And
Corey,
what's up?
Corey in the chat. I just love how huge the art is on them.
It is. They're gorgeous pieces. Yeah. They're gorgeous pieces. They're massive.
They're gigantic.
My buddy and I were up in a bookstore in up towards the Bay Area, and they had like a laser player. And it was pretty cheap. Laserdisc players were maybe $30.
Yeah.
But they had like a bunch of laser discs there. I mean, for nothing. Like he could have walked out of there with like I think it was like 10 movies for and the player for like maybe like $80. But he was gonna get like I mean, okay, he was gonna get like Die Hard, Terminator 2,
yeah,
fucking Alien, Aliens. I mean, like all this kind of cool shit. I was like, dude, for $80, fuck yeah, I'd do that, man. That'd be fun. I think it was a composite. It was a composite video too, so he could definitely plug it into some stuff he had at his house.
Yeah, I had an aunt and uncle growing up that had a video CD video player, video disc.
Yeah, my uncle was a weird dude. He had like he had like everything. He just bought everything because he did old auctions. Is how he got it. But he had a fucking his entertainment center was cool because it was a big fucking thing. I mean, this thing was like 12 feet yeah. long, big thing, big stacked up, and a nice cabinet. You open up the cabinets, there was some storage in there, but the bulk of it was like audio gear. I mean, it had a reel to reel freaking place for the VHS player. I mean, it was freaking bonkers. All the shit built into this thing. I don't think he ever used half of it, but you know, whatever. So, all right, folks. Well, we're gonna get a tangent here a little bit here and such like that too. But yeah, man. Thanks for chatting up with us. Maybe next time we'll Dungeon Synth it up, man. Like we can come in here and freaking just like start listening to some Dungeon Synth.
Yeah.
And kind of explore. We'll tag back and forth on it a little bit here. Actually, probably have to keep it on my end because I have the audio. It'd be kind of hard. Yeah, let's like really relay it all and play that with it. But yeah, we'll do it again next week, man. I had fun. Again, it's good to chat about this stuff too. No, I format stuff, man. For those who don't know, my background is I have a library science degree.
Yeah.
And so like media stuff, media formats and mitigation of formats and migration of formats is a big thing. One of the ways that like at UCLA when I was there, the library was making money was like we had one of the last reel-to-reel players in town. And so they were doing conversions for people. People like, you know, a guy's dad would die and they'd be like, hey, what's on these reel-to-reels? And they'd be like, all right, let's go take it in and freaking yeah. convert it to a CD for you. You know, so it's yeah, that stuff all exists out. That's how the guys on Ride and Easy that do when they do the Brown Acid compilations, that's how they get it all. Is the dude what's his name? I forget his name. The guy that owns Permanent Records. People come in and sell the record collections, and they'll get these 7-inch records of like bands' demos that like never did anything else.
Mm-hmm.
And then he'll be like, all right, this is cool. And then they'll try to contact people and, you know, hey, you know, we want to give you a few bucks to like put your record that you recorded 40, 50 years ago, like onto a compilation.
Like, that's a big
and
thing.
And they're like, all right. And a lot of these demos were just like some record executive was sitting there having lunch and kid come up and just drop it in his pocket and run off, you know?
Yeah.
Like they weren't, you know, meant to be sold or anything like that. So they're kind of unearthing all these kind of cool pieces. And
that's a big thing happening in the traditional heavy metal scene yeah. right now, is that all these like late 70s, like proto metal and like early 80s like speed metal demos just getting dug up, and you know, labels like ours, like No Remorse or like Shadow Kingdom, are just like, we'll put this out.
Yeah, yeah, go tell people, give some money. They're yeah. not gonna say no, but they haven't been making any money on it. They want to make some bucks on it now.
And then like, who knows, like maybe that thing could blow up, and then these guys who are like in pushing their 60s might reform and like play a festival gig or something.
You mean like Sir Uncle?
Yeah,
yeah, no, that's yeah,
like Darth Ungol,
dude. That like when they started playing shows again, man, it was yeah. like it was strong. You know, they came out, they didn't miss a beat.
I saw them at Legions of Metal last year.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I saw them at Psycho a few years back, but then they put a new album out, and it's pretty damn good, dude. Like,
yep.
I mean,
it murders.
I like that. I like these guys that aren't like, you know, they might get inspired to do some more. They see how much yeah. how much they impact they've had, how much they mean, and they come back and they throw some. They got more to offer, man. Fuck yeah, I love that stuff, dude. So all right, we're gonna bail. Sorry, I gotta eat dinner.
Yep.
Time I gotta do. Probably go to bed because it's late over there, I'm sure. But thanks everybody for hanging out with us. It's very cool. We'll do it again next week. I got Eyes as a Hash on Wednesday, and I got Thursday night. I have Lisa Penrose, who works for Dungeons & Dragons.
Yeah.
Coming up and hang out with and talk with me and my students. So yeah, please, Tucker, you got anything going on?
Thursday?
No, I mean just.
Oh, I mean, I have a recording session. I got another band coming through. That's why I'm moving all my shit around in this space, is getting ready to record a band down
nice,
here.
Nice, dude. Yeah, I like your space here. This is fun to see. I've seen work in progress. I like to see it unfold.
Yeah.
So all right, cool. All right, guys. Well, I'll catch you guys all later. Take it easy. All right.
Clear.